Hello friends, welcome to class number 2. In today's class, we are going to learn few things, few new concepts such as opportunity cost, and we are supposed to revise our class number 1. We may even do certain concepts of material, means relevant cost in terms of material, but before I proceed, let us come on to understand what we learnt in our last class. In last class, I told you an example of ITC. Let me start with that similar example, same example. ITC is a very big company. It manufactures even Ashirwad Atta. And the situation was like ITC has a spare capacity of 30,000 hours and it is thinking that whether it shall utilize those 30,000 hours in manufacture of pencil or not. Whether it shall leave such capacity spare itself or it shall utilize such capacity in manufacture of pencils. While taking decisions, we were supposed to think about relevancy of cost. We were supposed to think that whether a particular cost is relevant or not in terms of decision at hand. For example, in this situation, I told you that material is relevant cost because it is being incurred in future and it is being incurred just because we are manufacturing pencils. So we will say that material B's cost is relevant in nature. On the contrary, we learnt about few other costs that were not relevant or irrelevant. You will say, sir, what kind of cost was these? I told you that few costs are sunk and few are committed. Let me give you a very simple example of sunk cost and committed cost. If cost is incurred in past, means you did a commitment of making the payment in past, and if such payment is also done in past, then such cost is known as sunk cost. Past cost, historical cost, sunk cost, because such cost is not going to affect our decision, our future decisions. So we call such cost as sunk cost, hence irrelevant for our decisions. On the contrary, other kind of cost was you will say committed cost, wherein commitment was done in past or the payment for such commitment was done in future. So whenever we commit certain things in past, although payment is done in future, we call such things as committed cost, such costs as committed cost. Let me proceed further and guide you a bit about costs that are relevant in nature, because we are supposed to concentrate only on relevant cost. And while taking decisions, we need to make sure that we take care only only the costs that are relevant. We are not supposed to consider accounting treatment or irrelevant cost while taking the decisions. Why? Because I told you that accounting standards and accounting rules and regulations, be it as company law, be it accounting, are meant for stakeholders. They are not at all meant for management. Management think from different perspective. Management perspective is altogether different than that of shareholder, creditor, etc. For example, creditor thinks that his money shall get realized. He is least concerned about company's growth. Shareholder thinks that he shall reap good amount of dividend. He is least concerned with the growth of company. On the contrary, when we think from management's point of view, management do not think from point of view of profits. Rather, it thinks from point of view of the growth and harmony, rather you will say success of the company. If company didn't, means let us assume company do not have profit situation, then shareholder will definitely create issues. But if company is not earning profit but has good future growth aspects, management will be least concerned about profit. It will say no issues, we are not here for profit, rather we want long-term business growth. So thinking of management is altogether different from that of stakeholders. So whatever decisions we are going to learn, be it is financial or non-financial, we will learn purely from the point of view of management and not from the point of view of accounts, stakeholders, etc. Here we are going to deal with short-term decisions, decisions that do not involve net present value, are typically known as short-term decisions. And we learned three approaches we learned about. In first approach, I told you that we are supposed to calculate, for example, if there is a choice between production of pens or pencils on an unutilized capacity, you will say that we will go ahead individually one by one. First, we will calculate cost benefit analysis in terms of pens, then we will calculate cost benefit analysis in terms of pencils, and wherever our benefit is greater, we will obviously go ahead with that particular option. Second option was opportunity cost approach, in which we thought that we will go ahead with one particular decision. Generally, we go ahead with the decision that has higher revenue. We will go with particularly one decision, and we will take other decisions benefit as opportunity cost, means that benefit is not actually the cost, rather we are taking it as notional cost, and we subtract such cost along with other cost to arrive at net benefit or extra benefit, and we then analyze that whether we should proceed or not. It may be possible that in certain situation, for example, let me guide you, when we did this question, we found that net benefit was 5,000 if we proceed for pens rather than pencils. But let us assume this net benefit is minus 14,000. This net benefit is minus 14,000. Okay. Or minus 5,000 just. So whether you shall produce pens or pencils, on financial ground you will say we shall produce pencils, not pen, because net benefit of producing pen is negative. But it may be possible that non-financial benefits, non-financial factors may incline you to produce pens itself. So negative net benefit does not mean that you will take that particular decision itself. Yes, from financial grounds you can take that particular decision, but we need to take decision from holistic aspect and not just from financial aspect. Right now we are learning only from financial aspects, but we need to broaden our mind so that we can understand holistically and not just financially. Let me proceed with approach number three. Approach number three was incremental revenue and differential cost approach. In this I told you that obviously we will proceed with the product that has higher revenue. So we calculated the difference incrementing revenue if we chose that particular option. So you will say, sir, that's why, because there is increase in revenue only, there cannot be decrease in revenue, we chose incremental revenue option. And we found directly difference in revenue. What is the difference in revenue? What is the higher revenue? For example, 28,000 was revenue for pens, and 25,000 was for pencils. So you will obviously say that, sir, 3,000 is the difference. You will obviously say 3,000 is the difference. Let me now proceed with, incremental revenue and differential cost approach itself. If I do this question using incremental revenue and differential cost approach, the same question, what will be the solution? Please write down. Pens, pencils, and defense. Pens, pencils, and defense. $28,000. $25,000 and $3,000. What is this? I just said, if you produce pencils, you will earn $25,000. On the contrary, if you produce pen, you will earn $28,000. So obviously there is a difference, means increase. Here it is, it will be known as incremental profit of ₹3,000. It will be known as what? Incremental profit of ₹3,000. Then just a second. Cost costs are material A, material B, skilled labor, unskilled labor. There are other costs as well, but let us first of all begin with these four costs. Material A was being incurred on manufacture of pens, not pencils. So we will write 7,000 here. It was not being incurred on pencils, so you will say 7,000. Difference is 7,000. If I go with material B, it was only being incurred on pencils. So you will say if we produce pens rather than pencils, obviously 8,000 will be our savings. Savings means negative cost. Obviously, if you save something, it means what? Think in this way. I am saying 8,000 is my cost. It will come here. If I say 7,000 is my benefit or profit, it will come here. If I want to write it here, you will write it in negative way. Obviously, if rather than here, you want to write it here, you will write in a negative figure. So same thing is here. Because there is a saving of material B, you will say 8,000 is our savings, means negative figure. Skilled labor is again the same. It is being incurred only for pens. Skilled labor is for pens. How much? 3000. Unskilled labor is of 4000. Unskilled labor is of 4000. Okay, so till here there is no problem at all. If I proceed with remaining three costs, now you need to concentrate very much. First was non-refundable security. First was non-refundable security, and figure was 15,000. Few of you might say, sir, there is no need to write this figure because this is sunk in nature. I totally agree with you. That's why difference will be nil. Remember, sunk cost, committed cost will automatically get eliminated in this third way of doing the question, because here we are taking the difference. And obviously, when certain costs are not getting affected because of our decisions, so such cost will automatically be indifferent whether I take this decision or take that decision. So you will say, let us eliminate those costs. So it is nil. Then comes rent. You will say, here it is 4000. Please, let's wait for a minute, then I will come back to rent. Let's halt it. Next one was market survey. It was of 1000. It was for 1000 rupees. Now, again, I told you that because it is irrelevant cost to the decision whether I manufacture pens or pencils, obviously it doesn't create any difference in cost if I produce pens or pencils. It is going to be same whether I produce pens or pencils. So you will say what? You will say that it is 1000-1000, means difference is nil. So you will say here that market survey and non-refundable security are both nil. Hindi mein samjha dun. Non-refundable security kya hai? Sunk cost hai. Market survey kya hai? Committed cost hai. Yaad rakhi. Market survey kyunki effect ho hi nahi rahi. Chahe main pen banau, chahe main pencils banau. Ye effect ho hi nahi rahi. दोनों में पहले से कमिटमेंट हो रखा था कि हम 1000 देंगे, चाहे आप पेन बनाओ ना बनाओ, चाहे आप पेंसिल्स बनाओ ना बनाओ. सो ऑब्वियसली इनका डिफरेंस नील है. सो बेटर वे ये रहता है हमेशा कि इन दोनों को शो ही मत करिए, इनको शो ही मत करिए, ठीक है. लेकिन मैंने आपको शो किया है डिफरेंस समझाने के लिए, मैंने आपको शो किया. जनरली वी मेक ओनली लास्ट कॉलम, इवन हम दोनों ये दोनों कॉलम्स भी नहीं बनाते. हम लोग सीधा ही क्या बनाते हैं? लास्ट कॉलम बनाते हैं. लेट मी कंटिन्यू इन इंग्लिश. वी हैव डेलिबरेटली शोन नॉन रिफंडेबल सिक्योरिटी एंड मार्केट सर्वे हेयर इन फर्स्ट टू कॉलम्स, ऑल्दो वी आर नॉट सपोज टू इवन शो दिस कॉस्ट बिकॉज वी आर अवेयर दैट दीज आर इररिलेवेंट कॉस्ट एंड अल्टीमेटली दे हैव नो वैल्यू टू अस बिकॉज अल्टीमेटली देयर डिफरेंस विल बी नील. But in third approach, one more cost will automatically get eliminated. Apart from irrelevant costs, in third approach, which approach? Incremental revenue differential cost approach, there is one more cost that is getting eliminated that will have a difference of nil. And such cost is known as common cost. Now we are talking about rent. Such cost is known as common cost. What are common costs? Costs that are appearing similar in both the alternatives. They are relevant in nature, but are similar in both the alternatives, so they are common. Hence, if we take decision A or decision B, they are not going to create any difference. Hence, for third option, hence for third approach, you will say these costs will not have any value in difference figure. Hence, we may also say in a different way that common costs are can be taken as irrelevant while we are following third approach, that is incremental revenue and differential cost approach. I believe it is very much clear to you. Remember, we are not supposed to take non-refundable security and market survey here, not at all, because they are totally irrelevant. We are not supposed to take, but rent was a relevant cost. 4,000 was a relevant cost. It was clearly relevant. In both the options, whether we produce pen or pencils, we were supposed to take rent. On the contrary, when we follow third approach, incremental revenue and differential cost approach, what happened was, because we are calculating difference, automatically whatever the relevant costs were, they got automatically eliminated. Be it is sunk cost, be it is committed cost, all such costs that were irrelevant to the decision were automatically eliminated from our third column, difference column. But one more cost got eliminated, and that was rent, because it was common in both these situations. It is relevant. Remember one thing, rent is relevant cost for both for pens and pencils, but while taking difference column, because it was common, it got eliminated. If situation had been that this figure would have been 6,000, you would say that, sir, 2,000 will be relevant cost in such situation. But it is not the situation. Situation is pretty simple. Situation is what? Both are same. In that case, 4,000 would have been common cost and 2,000 had been relevant cost, because we are taking only difference in cost. So whatever the cost, whatever cost is common under two alternatives will be known as common cost and hence eliminated while calculating difference. Few may also say that in third approach, you take common cost as irrelevant cost. You may also say that common cost as is taken as irrelevant cost in third option. Got it? Let me proceed now with a very, very simple language question that appeared one or two times in examination past. And line was very simple. Let me show you question. Do not worry if you don't have book. Do not worry at all. Question 1. Sunk cost is irrelevant in decision making. Okay. But all irrelevant costs are not sunk costs. Explain with examples. We will say, yes, sunk cost is irrelevant cost in decision making. We all know about that. But if I say all irrelevant cost, remember, in third option, even the common costs are irrelevant. They are not sunk. So line is, but all irrelevant costs are not sunk cost. We are supposed to write this thing only. For example, here you will find that, for example, a comparison of two alternatives, alternative production methods, may result in identical direct material cost for both the alternatives. Here, common cost in this example is identical direct material cost. So even that will be irrelevant. So we can very easily say that sunk cost is irrelevant in decision making, but not all irrelevant cost. Here, by not all irrelevant cost, we mean including common cost, because in third way you will categorically write that while following third approach, means incremental revenue differential cost approach, even common costs are irrelevant. Even common costs are irrelevant. Hence you cannot say that all costs, that all irrelevant costs are sunk costs. Okay, let me now write few things for you. Write down. They were sunk not sunk rather irrelevant. As per total project approach. So you may cut them because there is no need to show them in examination. You can obviously cut them in examination. There is no need to write such costs. We will write only rent. We will write only what? Rent. Let's first calculate the total. Two thousand negative. You can write net benefit or net income. So your answer shall be, hence it is beneficial to produce pence over pencils. Hence it is beneficial to produce pence over pencils. And we will write here this method uses three column format. The first two columns presents the figures of two alternatives without considering principals of decision making while third column presents the incremental costs / revenue. Another option is to use a single column format that concentrates only on incremental costs and benefits. Let me guide you about that particular format. In that format, what we will do we will make incremental cost benefit analysis. We will make incremental cost benefit analysis. Incremental revenue of manufacturing pens, it is 3000. How come? 28,000 minus 25,000 means we are directly taking third column, we are not involving other two columns. Then we will subtract what? Obviously we will subtract differential costs of manufacturing pens. It is material A. Figure is 7000. Then comes material B. Here it was being saved. Material B is not going to be expended. Rather, this cost will be saved just because we manufactured pen. Then comes skilled labor. Kindly write fast. I already told you that I may not be able to lower my speed. If your speed is slow, I suggest you go through slides. Skilled labor. Then unskilled labor. Now you are aware that unskilled labor is being saved. Next was non-refundable security. Non-refundable security. Nil. Why nil? Because it is sunk. So let's not write it, or let's do one thing, write it down and write sunk cost. for our understanding. Then rent. Rent is 4000 minus 4000. See, I am not going to even write the difference of non-refundable security because we know that it is sunk, so there is no need to find the difference. But for rent, we will show the difference. We will show that there is a difference in cost. And last is market survey. We can skip these two if we want non-refundable security and market survey. If we don't want to show them in exam, it will not hamper even a single percent of our impression on examiner. So your total will be negative 2000. Your total will be negative 2000. Hence, net profit, you may say, or net incremental revenue is a better word. You can say that net incremental revenue of producing pens is 5000 rupees. Net incremental revenue of producing pens is rupees 5000. So let us write few things. First of all, just jot it down fast. Then we will write few things about rent. We need to understand that it is common cost. It is taken just because there is no difference, hence it is irrelevant for option 3, but it is relevant for both option 1, means approach 1, total project cost approach, and approach 2, means opportunity cost approach. We are compulsorily supposed to take this cost over there. You cannot say that let's skip this cost over there. Examiner will cut marks if you will do this kind of error. Remember, sunk cost and committed cost. This one is committed cost. Sunk cost and committed cost can be skipped from this incremental revenue differential cost approach, but common cost shall not be skipped from this approach. Got it? I hope all are with me now. So let's write notes on these things, and then we will write after this note that if I will write what that if it if figure had been 6000, then what will be the situation and similar things. Further, I will also write about that which approach will be shall be used at which place. For example, whether we shall follow total project cost approach or opportunity cost approach. So let's continue writing. And one more thing, I will definitely write certain things that this approach shall be used at this place, this approach shall be used at this place, but I may not be able to explain everything at this point of time because we have not done several concepts yet. So with the period of time, you will automatically understand that we shall primarily use opportunity cost approach, and if question specifically asks, we shall go for first approach or third approach. We will deal this thing. We will just write down silently everything now. And you are aware that power cut is there at my place, so I will take a small cut in the video. You will see a small cut, and we will resume the class after a small cut. Let's write down. Point one, if rent for production of pens and pencils had been 6000 and 4000 respectively, differential cost that is relevant cost would have been ₹2,000. Second point, remember rent is relevant cost for individual decisions about manufacturing of pens or pencils, but will be irrelevant between two options, hence shall be treated as irrelevant costs and shall be ignored while following incremental revenue and differential cost approach. While following incremental revenue and differential cost approach, now another question. Question is, as I told you, that which approach shall be followed at what particular time? Write down when to follow which approach to solve a problem. Solution. If question directs us to follow a particular approach, we shall follow that approach only. Otherwise, questions are typically like this: best approach. case one. Minimum price to be charged for the contract or acceptability of a contract. Opportunity cost approach. While calculating relevant cost of any contract, consider only incremental cost of that contract and opportunity cost of utilizing limited resources on contract as relevant cost, as relevant cost. Case two. Acceptability of alternative one over alternative two. Again, opportunity cost approach, treating common cost as relevant cost for each alternative. That is, calculating total project cost for each alternative. Or incremental cost approach. case 3 choice among three or more alternatives. Treat all alternatives individually as per case 1 or treat any one alternative as base and follow case 2 for remaining alternatives. For remaining alternatives. Cases for opportunity cost. Next topic है कि हमारी opportunity cost जैसे मैंने last class में बताया था वो discuss करेंगे opportunity cost के बारे में. So our next topic is about opportunity cost. We are supposed to discuss what is opportunity cost and we are going to do certain cases on opportunity cost. I know few of you might say that it is a very easy concept, there is no need to do such concept, but believe me, even though you might be aware about definition of opportunity cost as per intermediate, now it will be a bit more interesting one. Because you might have learned that opportunity cost is benefit foregone on next best alternative. Although I told you in last class that we will not think about next best alternative, rather opportunity cost is benefit foregone on alternative foregone. It's not next best alternative. But sir, we learned about opportunity cost as next best alternative. That's what I'm saying. We are at final level. We need to refine ourselves to the best level and to understand what is actually opportunity cost under different situations. There might be situations where next best alternative might not result into opportunity cost. So we need to understand what is actually opportunity cost, and we will go ahead with the definition of cost accounting standards and not any other thing. Let me now begin with cases for opportunity cost. Case 1. Case is let us assume that we are producing 3 products A, B, C, and let us say not we are not producing 3 products, rather we have limited resources and we are thinking that which of the 3 products we shall produce. This is some kind of this. For example, we have limited land, we are thinking that whether we shall plant bananas on it, apples on it, or let us say lychee on it. we are confused that what shall we do. So this kind of cases we are going to discuss. So first case is that if we can produce only one product, at a time from limited resources. These are also known as mutually exclusive offers. Example. Let's take two examples simultaneously. First example is that we have a land and we are thinking that whether we shall produce the either of the three products on that particular land. We can produce one thing at a time. We are farmer. And alternatively, you can take an example of, let us say, me. I teach at certain modes. So let's discuss about the modes that I use to teach. Suppose I'm taking my own example. Suppose Parag Gupta sir can teach at three different places at same time slot, where and he gets one place is say ITU. Let us say I teach face to face at ITU. Let us assume this is first place. Second place is say studio for virtual recording. Studio. You will say virtual, let us say live streaming for virtual classes. I am writing virtual classes. Because from next session, I will take live virtual classes as well. My plan was for this session as well, but certain technical issues crept up and I was unable to provide live virtual classes in this batch. No issues, from next batch we will have live virtual batches. And third is say again face to face, let us say at Gurgaon. My total contribution if I teach at ITU is say rupees 2 lakh. If I teach at studio, it is say 1,25,000, and at Gurgaon it is say 1,10,000. There are certain specific costs that are being incurred. You will say specific fixed cost, similar to rent, and say they are avoidable rent. For simplicity, I am saying avoidable. Sir, what would happen if they are unavoidable? I already told you there are certain cases we are going to take at later stage. You shall not be worried that what will be the situation if they are unavoidable. I will take them in few classes. So, if I teach at ITO because I need to hire an auditorium, obviously I require to pay them certain rent. 50,000 is the amount of rent. Let us say studio is at my home and I don't require anything to be paid specifically. And last is, let us say I teach in a classroom at Gurgaon. In that situation, rent will be just 5,000 rupees. I am thinking that if I teach at these places, what will be my benefit? So you will say, sir, your benefit will be, you will say, sir, your benefit will be, you might call it profit as well. Yes, it is profit because we haven't taken anything else. But we will consider benefit. Let me guide you why. Because in my example, I have not taken a big example where there were irrelevant costs. If there were some certain costs such as sunk cost, I am not considering those costs. Let us say certain cost was already incurred before I even decided to take the batch. Let us say I purchased laptop. Now the cost of laptop is already incurred. I'm not considering that cost in these three alternatives because it is irrelevant. It is sunk in nature, irrespective of this fact that I teach at ITO, studio or Gurgaon. That cost has already been incurred and it is not going to hamper my decisions. So I am going to take only those costs, those benefits, those revenues that are relevant to the decision at hand. In this case, there are three alternatives. We are supposed to think about all the alternatives, but we are supposed to take only which cost, which benefit, which revenue, only relevant. You are not supposed to take any irrelevant cost. Anything irrelevant is not supposed to be taken. We are thinking about three. Sir, you are saying in this way, like you taught us in pen and pencil, so we can say it easily that this is total project cost approach. Yes, you can say in that way as well that this is actually total project cost approach, wherein I have calculated benefit under three alternatives and I know that in under each alternative we have taken only relevant revenue and relevant cost. You can write it down if you want that these are only relevant cost, relevant revenues. So these are the benefits. Now I simply ask you that please, as a consultant to me, guide me that out of three alternatives, which alternative I should choose. Tell me. Obviously everybody will say that, sir, you shall obviously go for alternative one, ITU. Alternative one, ITU. Wonderful answer. But tell me if due to certain reason I am unable to choose ITO. Let us say I am afraid that riot might occur, riots, dangi might occur at ITO, or I say that some construction work is undergoing because of which students might face problem in reaching that place, or there is electricity or power cut issue, or any other issue is there because of which I am afraid to take class at ITO. You tell me which option should I go for, whether it is studio or is it Gurgaon. Obviously we will say from financial perspective, sir, you shall always go for studio. Okay. So I will say, let us say there is no Gurgaon. Let us say there is no Gurgaon. And I just want to understand that if I go for ITO, what is the additional benefit or net benefit I am going to earn? You will say, sir, it is very obvious that you are going to earn 1,50,000 in ITO. And in studio, you are going to earn 1,25,000. You are going to earn additionally 25,000. But sir, this is very simple example. In real life, examples are not so simple, not so easy to understand in a minute. So yes, we can understand that we need to calculate additional benefit or net benefit of choosing one alternative rather than other one. This is what we understand. You don't need to explain us that why we are calculating additional benefit. Obviously, because in real life, situations are not like this. They are not so simple. Situations are very complicated, wherein we need to understand why we shall go ahead for another first choice and not for second choice. We need to know what will be the additional benefit if we go for the first choice. So you will say, sir, if we go for this ITU, we will earn 150. If we go for studio, benefit will be 125. Your net benefit is 25,000. Okay. Now, I change this question slightly. Let us assume I don't know what net benefit I am going to get at IT. I don't know. I need to understand what shall be the minimum net benefit, what shall be the minimum benefit that I shall earn at ITU so that I shall choose that ITU rather than studio from financial perspective. I want to understand the minimum price. I'm thinking from minimum price point of view. What shall be the minimum benefit? You will say it's very simple. You are unaware about the total contribution. You are unaware about the benefit. You will say it's very simple. You will say you are earning 125 at studio. Obviously, you shall not be in worse off situation, means you shall at least earn 125 at ITU. If you want to go ahead with ITU and you don't want to be in worse off situation, your benefit shall be of 125. And if your benefit is 1.25 lakh, you can by reverse way calculate what shall be the minimum price that you shall charge from your customer so that you can yield that amount of benefit and so that it shall be beneficial to you. So it is very simple to think. So you will say what we are doing while thinking about opportunity. I am at simplest case. Sir, we know all this. Why you are teaching us? I know you are aware about this fact, but from simplest form to complex form, we need to start from simplest form only. So I am riding a ladder and I am going step by step. So the first step is we understood that we first need to calculate net benefit. Second thing, we understood that we need to calculate the minimum price. Let us say there can be alternate question. In one question, it can be that what is the net benefit? In alternate question, it can be that what should be the minimum price that you shall charge so that you shall yield, you shall not be in worse off situation. This can be a question in front of you. Now, you will say, sir, we are well aware about these two questions. Now, let us complicate the case. Now, let us assume that because of certain non-financial reasons, I am willing to proceed with studio. You said, why you are willing to proceed with studio? I said, because I know that in today's world, even the kids are using tablets for their studies. You know that Byju's and other companies are there in kindergarten, starting from kindergarten to till 12th, K-12. They are providing tablets, they are providing classes at tablets. So obviously in future, students will be more inclined towards tablets and streaming, live streaming, other kind of forms, because internet is so cheap in today's date and technology is widespread now. So it is not far away that everybody will be willing to go ahead with such kind of platforms. So obviously I am thinking in futuristic way. My strategy is altogether different. So I am willing to go ahead with studio irrespective of this fact that I am earning fewer benefit than ITU. Then my question to you is, you tell me, don't you think if I go for studio, what will be my benefit? What will be my benefit? It will be 1,25,000. Now, how do we calculate opportunity cost? Think now, listen to me now very carefully. I chose studio because of XYZ reason, XYZ or XYZ reason, whatever you want to say. I chose studio. Now, you will say, if let us assume there was no studio, if let us assume there was no studio, what will happen? You will say, if there is no studio, which alternative should you have chosen? Which option must be opted by you? You will say that obviously I should have gone for ITU and not for Gurgaon if there was no option for studio. Let us change the figure. You will say if this is 2 lakh, then obviously I will go for Gurgaon and not for particular ITU if this studio option is not there. So the best way to calculate opportunity cost is, let us think that that particular option is not available. What we are going to think that that particular option is not available. Now, out of the rest, we need to think that which option we would have opted if studio option is not there. And that particular option's benefit will be known as what? You will say opportunity cost, because you lost that option just to follow this option. So you will say, let us assume in this case benefit of ITO is 1,50,000, and you will say, although we suffered a net benefit of -25,000, but why we suffered it? Because obviously you were willing to go ahead with studio. Last part, let us assume I am willing to go ahead with Gurgaon. Reason may be because although it is far away from my place, but let us assume it is very near to my place. Because of proximity, I want to go ahead with Gurgaon. So what you will choose? You will say, sir, if I choose Gurgaon, I will earn 1,05,000. But just because I chose Gurgaon, I earn 1,05,000. I chose Gurgaon because of non-financial factors. Now, if I didn't have the option of Gurgaon, which option should I choose? You will say, obviously, you will go for ITU. So, if you choose ITU, in that particular situation, you will say that I lose the opportunity of earning 1,50,000. You will say, I lost an opportunity to earn what amount? 1,50,000. Remember, non-financial decision is only seen for the option that we are choosing. You will not say that non-financial factors shall be seen for ITU and studio as well. If you really want to see non-financial factors for ITU and studio as well, that is out of our curriculum, let me be categorically clear, then you need to write that weight of this financial and non-financial factor, let us say 1,25,000 plus non-financial factor, is greater than this financial factor of 1,50,000. That's why this is our opportunity. You need to be categorically clear, but this is clearly out of our curriculum. So what we don't need to complicate it. We need to simply understand that first, write down the decision you are taking because of XYZ reason. Do not think about why we chose it. If you chose that particular decision, now because of that decision, you lost an opportunity to earn something. Which opportunity? Obviously, we will compare the benefit of rest of the alternatives. Whatever benefit is greatest will be our opportunity cost, because if Gurgaon option was not available, we would have opted that particular option because of highest benefit. Now we forgone that particular benefit just because we chose Gurgaon option. So you will say that our opportunity cost is nothing else but opportunity cost is benefit foregone. I believe it is very, very simple. I believe we shall not be confused with non-financial factors, because I told you a line just because few of you might have certain questions, but you need to keep non-financial factors at bay at this moment. Means aapko usko non-financial factors ko bhi alag rakhna hai. While calculating opportunity cost or other things, aapko sirf financial factors hi dekhne hain. Aapko non-financial factors ke baare mein abhi humne discuss karna shuru hi nahi kiya. To opportunity cost kaise dekhte hain? Opportunity cost dekhne ka sabse simple tarika hai. Aapko ye dekhna hai ki aapko kaun sa option choose karne ki kaha hai. क्यों कहा है हमें मतलब नहीं, जो भी रीज़न है चाहे वो फाइनेंशियल फैक्टर है चाहे नॉन फाइनेंशियल फैक्टर, उस रीज़न के हम बेनिफिट को ले लेते हैं, उस बेनिफिट को उस ऑप्शन के बेनिफिट को ले लेते हैं। अब हम क्या करते हैं, अब ये सोचते हैं कि अगर ये ऑप्शन होता ही नहीं तब क्या करते। अच्छा, अगर गुड़गांव वाला ऑप्शन होता ही नहीं तो क्या करते। अरे सर, उस केस में तो ITO पे ही जाते, उस केस में स्टूडियो में थोड़ी क्लास लेते। मैंने कहा बात तो ठीक है, उस केस में आप क्या करते, ITO पे जाते। क्यों? क्योंकि आपको ज़्यादा बेनिफिट होता। कितना बेनिफिट होता? 1,50,000। स्टूडियो में कितना होता? 1,25,000। तो आप कहेंगे जस्ट बिकॉज मैंने गुड़गांव चूज़ किया, मैं ITO जो मैं चूज़ करने वाला था वो चूज़ नहीं कर पाया। क्यों? क्योंकि अगर गुड़गांव ऑप्शन नहीं होता तो मैं किस पे जाता? ITO। मैं स्टूडियो पे तो जाता ही नहीं, तो गुड़गांव को चूज़ करने के लिए मैंने कौन सा फॉरगो कर दिया? मैंने ऑब्वियसली गुड़गांव को चूज करने के लिए मैंने ITO वाला ऑप्शन फॉरगो कर दिया। सो दिस ऑप्शन विल बी नोन एज आवर अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट। ठीक है, बहुत सिंपल था, बहुत सिंपल था। आप इसमें फार्मर के हिसाब से सोच सकते हैं। एक फार्मर को तीन तरीके के क्रॉप्स लगानी है, ही इज विलिंग टू अप्लाई टू प्रोड्यूस थ्री काइंड ऑफ क्रॉप्स, विच क्रॉप शैल ही ऑप्ट? ऑब्वियसली लेट अस से ही वेंट फॉरवर्ड फॉर वन पर्टिकुलर क्रॉप। नाउ यू विल थिंक दैट व्हाट इज द अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट ऑफ गोइंग, why we are calculating opportunity cost, so that we can understand certain things such as you will say we need to understand that what is the benefit foregone, we need to understand what additional benefit we get if I opt for this particular option. So you will say, let us say I opt for X option. So you will say if humne option nahi opt kiya tha, if we had not opted this option, which option we had went for, which crop we had went for, and the benefit foregone on that particular crop is known as opportunity cost. Kindly write down. Now, if आई नो आई एम प्रिटी स्लो, आई नो आप लोगों को समझ में आ गया था, तब भी मैं बहुत धीरे धीरे समझा रहा था। बट देखो दोस्तों, यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड फ्यू थिंग्स दैट सर्टेन स्टूडेंट्स आर स्लो एंड वी नीड टू फर्स्ट ब्रिंग देम टू आवर लेवल सो दैट वी शैल ऑल बी एट सेम लेवल and after reaching that particular level we all will pick up our speed. Now, if Parag Gupta sir chooses to teach at studio due to future prospects or any other reason, he will forego benefit on alternative foregone, that is ₹5,000 at ITO. Because it is quite obvious that if satellite option was not chosen, then not satellite, it is studio. Right, studio. Then Parag sir would have opted for ITU's option and not Gurgaon. And not Gurgaon. Now, let me proceed with certain new concepts and then we will do a question on this opportunity cost and then we will go for a break. Let's start with the concept of fixed cost. See, let us assume there is a fixed cost that is given in question, but nothing is mentioned. Now, whether we shall assume such fixed cost as avoidable in nature or that fixed cost shall be treated as unavoidable in nature, that's the question. Whether we shall treat such fixed cost as avoidable or such fixed cost shall be treated as unavoidable in nature. You will say, obviously, we shall choose and treat such fixed cost as avoidable in nature. I said no. Remember, fixed cost is always unavoidable. I deliberately ask this question to you because I am aware that several of you opted for avoidable option because I have been choosing avoidable as an example till yet. And you might be thinking that because I am taking avoidable, it is unavoidable. And yes, there were few of you that were also correct, that thought that fixed cost is unavoidable. Let me guide you why fixed costs are always unavoidable. Kindly clear me, what is this? Sir, this is a graph of fixed cost. We learnt at intermediate level wherein I was taught that irrespective of units, our fixed cost is going to remain constant. This was the graph. If I am not wrong, yes sir, this was the graph. Now tell me, how many units are this? Sir, these are 0 units. How many? Let us say these are 10,000 units. So you are saying, let us say fixed cost is 5 lakh rupees. You are saying, sir, this fixed cost of 5 lakh rupees will remain constant irrespective of our level of output. Irrespective of the fact that we produce 10,000 units or we produce 0 units, our fixed cost will remain constant of that is rupees 5 lakh. Okay, so what shall be done? You will say that fine, let's understand this very clearly, categorically clearly, that because our output is volatile in real life, it can be 0, it can be 10,000. We were taught that fixed cost is certain cost that cannot be avoided. For example, we take a building on rent, and rent is under a contract, if you are aware. You cannot take tenancy without a contract. Let us say 11 months contract is there, because if it is more than 11 months, you need to register it. So let us say it is 11 months contract. So you will say, sir, we cannot revoke contract on our will. If we enter into a contract of 11 months, we are compulsorily bound to follow that contract and we are compulsorily supposed to pay the rent. irrespective of this fact that we stop our production, we close our company or anything. If we have taken something on rent, we need to pay. For example, you have a postpaid connection. Irrespective of this fact that you make one call, zero call, 1 lakh calls, your postpaid rental will remain same. Postpaid company will say that if you have closed, let us say company is Vodafone, they will say if you are not interested in continuing with us, you should have specifically, categorically told us. So what I want to say is, if question has not categorically told you that this rent is, this fixed cost is avoidable in nature, you are supposed to compulsorily assume that even if units produced are zero, this fixed cost will incur. You cannot treat such fixed cost as avoidable in nature. Got it? You need to be very clear in this, that such fixed cost will be treated as unavoidable. So let us write it down, that if fixed cost, if nothing is mentioned about fixed cost, we will compulsorily treat it as unavoidable whenever question is silent. We will always treat fixed cost as unavoidable fixed cost although such fixed cost may be specific fixed cost. What we mean by specific fixed cost? Let us say we have a factory of Pepsi. We are Jajuices or what is that company? Jajuices is bottling plant of Pepsi and is situated near Jammu. Greater Noida plant, I forgot the name of the company, it's a sister concern of Jajuices. That is bottling plant of Pepsi towards North India. So we are bottling plant of Pepsi, and there are several kind of bottles. One is plastic bottle, one is glass bottle. Let us take, rather than taking several size bottles, we are taking two bottles only. One is plastic bottle and one is, let us say, glass bottle of Pepsi. Now we are aware that there are certain costs that are specific to particular bottle. Let us say a particular plastic bottle requires a certain kind of supervisor, that is, or certain kind of fixed cost that is compulsory supposed to be on that particular plant or on that particular plastic bottle only. So you will say, since such fixed cost is specific in nature to a particular product and not to the company as a whole, then also such fixed cost shall be treated as unavoidable in nature, unless question hints you or unless question specifically tells you. Specific fixed cost and not common fixed cost, common or general fixed cost. Such cost will be incurred even if we stop producing the product. remember discretionary fixed cost is equal to is another name of avoidable fixed cost, and committed fixed cost is another name for unavoidable fixed cost, and we are aware that such fixed costs are in irrelevant costs. Such fixed costs are irrelevant costs. Let's do one thing. I think we shall first go on to a break. By that time, before coming back to the from the break, if you don't have books, don't worry at all. Simply borrow or simply download the book, first five lectures notes from the link I will mention in the break. Also, this link shall be kept very very much close to you, because I will keep on uploading several things on this particular link itself. I will not tolerate at later stage that I don't have the link, please provide me the link. You need to go through this link on your own, you need to write it down, and you need to keep this link very safe, because this link is very important for you. Whatever I want to share with you will be uploaded on this link automatically, be it is my PowerPoint slides, be it is certain books, international books. If I want to share certain international books, I will upload those books on this link, and you are supposed to go through this link. So let me go into break, and let's come back after our 10 minutes break. वेलकम बैक आफ्टर द ब्रेक। चलिए लेट अस कम ऑन टू अ क्वेश्चन एंड सी हाउ वी शैल प्रोसीड विद अपॉर्चुनिटी कॉस्ट क्वेश्चन। काइंडली कम ऑन टू क्वेश्चन नंबर 8, पेज नंबर 214। क्वेश्चन 8, पेज 214। It's a very small question. If you don't have books, you can even take snap of this question so that you shall not face problem. Just one question will be there. I am reading this question along with you. Let's read it. Just a second. A company can make any one of the three products X, Y or Z in a year. It can exercise its option only at the beginning of year. Relevant information about the products for the next year is given below. These informations have been provided to you. You are required to compute opportunity cost for the year for each of the products. Means if we produce X, what will be the opportunity cost? If we produce Y, what will be the opportunity cost? And if we produce Z, what will be the opportunity cost? This is the same thing that I showed you earlier, means examiner comment, wherein students were unable to calculate opportunity cost in the different products. So let us proceed with question number 8. Let us write down on our register. Question 8, page 214, I think. It was page 214. Yes, page 214. And I don't think I need to guide you that question number shall always be in the middle top of the register, because in examination we are supposed to write it at the top, because this left margin is meant for examiner. He is supposed to give marks over here. So you are compulsorily supposed to write question number at the top middle of your answer sheet. Let's begin with this question. So we are aware that we have three products. How many products? Three products: X, Y, and Z. We are aware about this thing. And we also know that selling price has been provided to you. So obviously your 4 rupee, 3 rupee and 5 rupee is contribution per unit. Above that, you are aware that your market demand is 3000, but you can produce only 2000. So obviously how many units you will produce and sell? Because you are able to produce only 2000 units of X, although sales can be more than that, you can only produce 2000, so you will sell only 2000. So your total contribution in such situation will be, you will say, 8000. This is your total contribution. Again, for Y, you will say 3 rupees. Now market demand is of 2000, but you can produce 3000. Obviously, if you cannot sell more than 2000, why will you produce? So you will not produce more than 2000. You will say, I will produce only 2000 units. I will not produce more than 2000 units. So your total contribution will be 2000 into 3, 6000. Here 5 rupees. So 5 here, lower of 2 is 900, means 4500. So what will be the opportunity cost? You will say opportunity cost is very simple if you produce X. So how do we calculate opportunity cost? Remember, recall the concepts I told you. First thing, that you do not have the option of producing X. If you do not have the option of producing X, which product you would choose? You will say, I would go for Y. So you chosen Y just because its contribution was 6000 rather than Z, because contribution of Z was 4500, lower than 6000. So you will say, that means that if I have an option of choosing X, and let's say I choose X, so obviously I forgiven my opportunity of earning rupees 6000. So this is my opportunity cost. Same concept will apply if let us assume we are willing to produce Y. So you are willing to produce Y, so obviously what you will do, you will cross this product. You will say, if I don't have the chance to produce Y, which option shall I choose? You will say, obviously I shall choose X. And because you are choosing X, you will say, not Z, because contribution of Z is lower than that of X. So you will say, obviously my opportunity cost is of rupees 8,000. And last is similar to this one. You will say, last is similar. If you are willing to produce Z, let's cross it. You will say, if we don't have the option to produce Z, which option will you choose? You will say X. So you will say our opportunity cost is 8,000. Our opportunity cost is 8,000. Let's write them in proper examination presentation. Now question is, what is examination presentation? Do we have any format as we have in our accounts? Do we have any prescribed format or any defined guidelines? In the similar version, we make balance sheet. That balance sheet will be prepared in this performa only. Do we have any such performa? Answer is no. We don't have any such performa. What we need to do, we need to think and write whatever is given in question. We need to write the information in a very lucid manner, lucid means simple manner. And we need to write it in a way that everybody shall be able to understand it without any special knowledge. So let's start with this question. You are aware that how many products do we have? Three products, X, Y, and Z. How many products do we have? Three products, X, Y, and Z. Now, what is market demand? You will say units. Market demand has been given as 3,000, 2,000, and 1,000. You are aware that this is your market demand, 3,000, 2,000, and 1,000. Now you are confused that whether we will be able to sell these many units or not. Although there is demand. Demand means sales. Remember one thing very important. One thing is very important because students get confused in this concept. Remember, write it down on the first page of your register. Demand means sale, means what customers are demanding from us. And supply means purchase, means what we are purchasing from suppliers, what suppliers are supplying to us. Students generally get confused in these terminologies. So I suggest that we shall follow these terminologies in a very clear manner. You have been provided with demand. The next thing you need to understand is whether we are able to provide this many units, we are able to sell these many units or not. So rather than coming on to contribution, first thing we need to understand is we need to calculate our units. Whenever there is a question, we need to be clear what units we can produce, how many units we can sell. And this is the prime most important, first most thing we are supposed to do. So first thing is calculate units. How come? First write demand, then write production, then write possible production or possible sale. Let's do it. You are aware about production capacity. You are aware about production capacity. Now, possible production in units is 2,000, 2,900. What is this? Obviously, you will say lower of market demand or production capacity. So we are now clear about the number of units we can produce. Next thing is we need to calculate contribution per unit. Remember, we need to make a way that we shall follow every time we confront a question. So first thing is we need to know how many units. Second is contribution per unit. So to calculate contribution per unit, let's calculate, well, let's see what is our selling price. Let us see what is our selling price. Out of such selling price, we will subtract variable cost, which is 6, 9, and 7. 6, 9, and 7. Okay. Actually, recently I upgraded my Windows, and since then I am facing very much problem in my laptop because drivers of fan has not been upgraded yet, and anyhow, let's proceed. So I know you might be facing certain issues while I write, means on certain occasion screen gets up and few other issues, but I request you to cooperate. Anyhow, let us come on to contribution per unit. It is 4, 3, 5. What is contribution per unit? 4, 3, 5. Now, you can easily arrive at total contribution, that is 8,000, 6,000, and 4,500. How come? Possible production into contribution per unit. Let me remind you that you are not supposed to write red figures in examination. Red figures are meant for calculation purpose only, for understanding. They are rough figures. Only blue pen is supposed to be used in examination. So your opportunity cost will be 6,000 here, 8,000. We just calculated the same. Kindly write it fast. Now, after this, let us proceed for another case. Case 2. Another situation where, let us assume we are producing 3 products simultaneously. Let us assume a situation. For example, we have a factory or land where, for example, we have a factory of Pepsi. We produce more than one kind of Pepsi bottles, Varun beverages or Jai juices. You will see we are producing, let us say, plastic bottles, small size glass bottles, large size glass bottles, large size plastic bottles. So there are several products. Or you may say that we are farmer, we are producing several crops simultaneously in different section of our field. So similar kind of situation is there. Or if I am a teacher, let us say I teach at three time slots, morning, afternoon, evening. I teach students in these three time slots. So what we shall do if a person is teaching or if a person is producing more than one product at a time, right? How we will find opportunity cost? If more than one products are being produced from limited resources, offers are not mutually exclusive, offers are not mutually exclusive, example. I am taking the same example, but now means that studio, face to face, Gurgaon. I am taking the same example, but now with different time slots. Let me write the example. Suppose Parag sir is currently teaching at three places, at say different time slots. And he gets let me copy the figures from above. You can write them. I will give you ample amount of time. Kindly copy the same from your register. It will be easy for you. Just write it fast. I am waiting. Please write fast. Fast. Kindly write fast. Let me now proceed. I hope everyone has already written. Please write down. Yeah, or let's first understand what concept I am willing to teach you. Here I am assuming that in morning I teach at ITO, in afternoon I teach at studio for virtual classes, and for means my evening time slot is booked for Kurukam face to face, and I am earning this many amount of contributions or profit, whatever it is, from these different sources. Now my question is, let us assume I get one more option of teaching, let us say at Connaught Place. I'm already engaged in all three time slots, and I got one more time slot to be engaged for Connaught Place. You will say that, sir, how come you will teach at Connaught Place? I'm confused what to do. Let us assume teaching at Connaught Place is very, very required. Because of XYZ reasons, because of non-financial factors, I cannot skip it. It is very important for me, and I am ready to skip any of the three options to get that option of Connaught Place. Means aap teeno mein se koi sa bhi ek option chhodne ko ready hain if you want to go ahead with Connaught Place. Obviously, agar mujhe choice mili jaye, if you have a choice, you will definitely choose the option in which you will forgo least, in which you will forgo least contribution or least benefit. Here you will not think that we shall go for higher number, higher amount, because here we are having all three, we are producing three products, and you are at choice to leave one, and you don't want to lose your benefit. So you will definitely lose that one, that product that yields least amount of benefit to you. Which one is that? You will say Gurgaon is the option that I will forego. It will not be ITO, because you are earning most at ITO. You won't forego ITO, not at all, not under any situation. You won't even dream of leaving ITO. So you will say the situations are two, and very easy situations are, if we are having one at a time, one product at a time. So choosing a product means losing another product. Choosing a product after after those three alternatives means losing other alternative. So obviously, whatever benefit we have in next best alternative, or whatever alternative we forego, means you say that when agar humne ye wala option na choose kiya hota to hum kis pe jaate. If we had not chosen this option, which option you have chosen? Jis option ko hum choose karte us pe jo benefit hum kamate wo chhod diya, isliye wo opportunity cost. The benefit we would have earned on choosing that particular option that we have left now just because we chose this particular option is opportunity cost. But in this situation where we have more than one products at a time, not at a time, in different time slots, we will definitely be willing to forego that particular option. We will definitely be willing to forego that particular option wherein we are earning least contribution. So let us proceed and write down this thing. Now, if Parag sir receives an offer to teach a face-to-face batch at CP rather than one of the above set places, obviously he will forgo, obviously he will forgo Gurgaon's face-to-face classes to teach at CP. Here, benefit foregone of rupees 1,05,000 will be opportunity cost of teaching at CP. Opportunity cost of teaching at CP. Got it? Kindly write it fast. Let us come on to a question. Let's see question number. Which question we are going to deal now? Just a second. Let me take an easy one for you. Yeah, this one. Question 11, page 221. Let us come on to question number 11, page 221. Let me read this question for you. Mr. X has taken a shop on lease and made a down payment of 2,50,000 rupees. You are, let us say, Mr. X, and you took a shop on lease and you made a down payment of rupees 2,50,000. Okay. Now, down payment. What is down payment? You must be aware that down payment is not security amount. It is obviously, it is something that is not going to be refunded. Anyhow, let us read it further. Additionally, the rent and the lease amount is rupees 96,000 per annum. Annual rent is 96,000. Okay. If lease agreement is cancelled by Mr. X, then initial payment is forfeited. Obviously, examiner has made it much clearer that obviously because it is down payment, it is not going to be refunded. It is going to be forfeited. Mr. X plans to use the shop for general stores business and has estimated operations for next year as follows. Now you have a general store business and you believe that in upcoming year your sales are going to be 25 lakh, out of which VAT will be paid to VAT will be 2,80,000. So obviously your net of VAT, sales net of VAT, will be 22,20,000, and this will be your cost. You will earn a profit of net profit of 18,000. In the business, Mr. X will be devoting half of his time. However, no provision has been made for his remuneration or salary. Means no opportunity cost, nothing has been provided for the time he is devoting this business, so you shall not be worried about that. This line is of no use to us. Mr. X has an option to sublet the shop to his friend for a monthly rent of 18,000 rupees if he does not use the shop himself. 18 into 12, it is 216,000. So he can sublet and earn a rental of 2,16,000 if he don't run the business. You are required to identify the sunk and opportunity cost in the above problem. Sunk cost is very clear. Sunk cost is very, very clear. It is down payment. Whether rent is sunk, no. It is a relevant cost because it is avoidable in nature. It will be paid only in a situation you continue either in terms of business or subletting of business, subletting of rent of shop. So it is relevant. Okay, opportunity cost. You are thinking about opportunity cost. So if nothing is mentioned, obviously it means that opportunity cost shall be calculated when we continue our business. If you are confused, you can show opportunity cost in both the situations. Means if we don't continue our business and sublet the shop, and second, if we continue our business and don't sublet the shop. But we know that opportunity cost means benefit foregone on other alternative, nothing else more than that. State the most profitable decision which should be taken by Mr. X, supporting with appropriate calculations. You need to tell that which one is the most profitable decision and tell according to your appropriate calculations. So let us start. Let us come on to, first of all, start with a situation when we carry the business. We will evaluate that which costs are relevant and which are not, and we will write down accordingly. So right, let's write it. Statement showing, what is the name of statement? Cost benefit analysis. Cost benefit analysis of running own business. Using what? We are using relevant cost analysis. Obviously, we are going to follow relevant costing. Okay. So, first thing was sales after VAT. If you don't have the book, kindly click a snap of this question. It is a very simple question. Kindly click it fast. Second snap. Okay, let's continue. So sales after VAT is this, and cost of goods sold, obviously relevant. Wages, obviously relevant if nothing has been mentioned. Rent including down payment, no. Only 96,000 will be relevant. That 250,000 will not be relevant. Rates relevant, audit relevant. So every cost apart from our down payment is relevant cost. Let us calculate. Relevant costs, first is cost of goods sold, 12,50,000. Wages, 2,76,000. Rent, remember only rent is supposed to be taken. Only rent is supposed to be taken means you can say 3,46,000 minus 2,50,000, that is 96,000. Rates, 2,80,000. Audit, 50,000. So you will say these are your relevant costs. Now, because nothing is mentioned, you can either go ahead with total project cost approach or opportunity cost approach. But I already told you last question that remember, do not think about the situations, always follow opportunity cost approach unless there is something as such which shall be specially calculated by other two approaches. We shall always follow opportunity cost approach only. So I will proceed with opportunity cost approach in this question. Opportunity cost for subletting. Relevant revenue. ₹18,000 into 12 months, 2,16,000. Minus relevant cost, 96,000. So figure is 1,20,000. Figure is 1,20,000. We took opportunity cost along with other relevant cost, and our total will become sales after VAT was 22 lakh something. It was 22,20,000. So this will be now, I shall categorically repeat that I have deliberately calculated the figures, they are available to me, but you shall go back home and do your calculations. It may be possible that I commit certain clerical errors. I am very good in committing clerical mistakes, so I humbly request you to commit to check, cross verify these things. Net benefit. ₹1,48,000. So you will say obviously because benefit is more in running our own business, we shall continue running our own business. So you will say hence it is advisable to run own business. This was part number two, not part number one, sorry. This was part number two. And let us come on to part number one, wherein we were supposed to provide about sunk cost, etc. So part one is about sunk cost. We are aware that down payment of ₹2,50,000 is our sunk cost. And what is our opportunity cost? Opportunity is obviously 1,20,000 along with one more opportunity was, you don't know what was the salary that person was supposed to get, Mr. X was supposed to get for the time he invested over here. So we wrote in this way that whatever amount he would have earned if he had invested that time somewhere else, half day or half time, that salary will be our opportunity cost. This shall be our answer. Very simple question, very, very easy question. I believe all of you love this question. Let me now proceed in terms of main core area of decision making. What do you mean by main core area? Friends, I will guide you now for around 2-3 classes about relevant costs in terms of cost of production. Yes, although let me be categorically clear that your study material do not cover these kind of questions. Very means questions, you might find questions till this level, but beyond this level you might not find very much questions. Only one or two questions will be there, maximum one question, new course study material, and they were deliberately deleted by ICAI. Means if you go through your old syllabus study material, there were more than 100 questions in old syllabus study material, but now only one or two questions. But to safeguard ourselves, what we are doing, we are still continuing to do questions at length. And let me be very, very clear again and again, these questions, I really doubt that questions of this stretch will be asked in examination. One question of concepts till this level may be asked, or one question of one of combined concepts of all whole chapter might be asked. Because earlier, what was the syllabus in old course? Decision making was one of the main primary chapter. Now this decision making has been reduced dramatically, and our strategic based questions, strategic based topics have been increased very high, very much. But point here is that I cannot take any risk, so we will deal these questions at a very good stretch, and I need your cooperation to understand everything. From now onwards, where for 2-3 classes, whatever I will deal, there is only one question, that too only in practice manual, means question bank of ICAI, that it has posted on its website. I don't know whether physical copy is available or not. You can do that question. It will cover all kind of material, material relevant cost, labor relevant cost, but you won't find, you won't find any question on the topics I'm going to deal in core study material. Anyhow, before I proceed, let me guide you a bit about what is cost, what is actually cost. And I think everybody of you are aware about this, that what are the elements of cost. Still, I am writing it at a very high pace. What are the elements of cost? Yes. First is material, very good. Second is labor, and third is other expenses. Material can be further subdivided into two categories. First is direct material, and second is indirect material. Labor can further be divided into two categories: direct labor and indirect labor. Other expenses direct and indirect. Okay. Now, what is direct cost? What is indirect cost? Let's do one thing. Let's write everything, then I will explain it to you in 1 minute only. If we add all three indirect costs it becomes overhead. It becomes overhead. Overhead can be of following types. Production or work overhead, then administrative overhead, you can write shorthand of overhead as O/H, selling overhead, and distribution overhead. Okay, let me now explain you, then we will write further. Let us assume that there are two brothers, one is Chunnu, one is Munnu. There are two brothers, one is Chunnu, another one is Munnu. So they live in a house, family owned house, mother is the owner. Chunnu has installed a direct D2H of Videocon, let us say. Chunnu, don't write, D2H is of Videocon, and Munnu, D2H is of, let us say, Tata Sky. Now, I ask a very simple question to you, whether we can trace this cost of D2H directly to Chunnu. You will say yes, of course, because this cost is directly incurred by Chunnu itself, that's why it is known as direct cost. As we all know, if we own a house, a property, we need to pay house tax to government. We are supposed to pay house tax to government. Now, you own a house and you are supposed to pay house tax, so you thought, let's think that this house tax will be paid by mother. Now question is, what will mother do? You will say, sir, mother will divide. Okay, mother will divide house tax between two brothers. That Chunnu, you are supposed to pay this much amount, and Munnu, you are supposed to pay this much amount. Okay, let's say there is single electricity meter, because of which single electricity bill is there. Again, the same is being paid by mother. What will mother do? Again, she will divide it between Chunnu and Munnu. Let's say there is no expenditure of mother and every expenditure is supposed to be borne by Chunnu or Munnu. So you will say, sir, in this situation, we need to be very cautious, because it may be possible that, for example, is house tax. It may be possible that Chunnu has utilized two rooms and Munnu has utilized just one room. So obviously, we'll say that because Chunnu has utilized two rooms and Munnu has utilized one room, you shall divide such house tax in 2:1. When we read these concepts in overhead chapter at intermediate level in cost accounting, we were taught about certain terminologies. We will apportion, means portion the house tax into two parts. We will absorb, means we will say this amount is to be borne by you. You will absorb this much amount of expenditure, and Munnu, you will absorb this much amount of expenditure. Why absorb? Think in this way: you have a sponge, this is a house, and there are three colors, liquid colors available. First, you dip sponge in first color, then second color, then third color. What is sponge doing? It is absorbing the color, and after all the colors are absorbed, this whole product is let us say build up. So you will say costs are similarly absorbed in a product. We absorb cost in similar way in a product. Whatever cost is there which is not directly traceable, we absorb it. We absorb it on the basis of different basis. Few call it allocate, few call it applied. We are not supposed to go into nitty-gritties why we call it allocate, why we call it absorb, why we call it recover, why we call it apply. Let's forget all that. Let's stick to basic meaning. Basic meaning is that any expenditure that cannot be traced directly will be known as overhead. Why overhead? Because obviously it is going over our head. In Hindi we call it sir ke upar se nikal jati na, samajh mein nahi aata ki how shall we absorb, we don't understand how shall we absorb it on different products, what shall be the right base for absorbing. That's why we call overhead sir ke upar se, it is going over our head. Like overhead cables, got it? So what we are doing is we need to absorb these expenditures. So whenever an expenditure or cost is not directly traceable, we call it as indirect cost. We call such cost as indirect cost. And when any cost is directly traceable to a product, we call such cost as direct cost. In certain situations, few costs may be direct at certain areas at certain point of time, but may treat as indirect at certain point of time. For example, for mother, house bill is direct, house tax bill is direct cost. If we are calculating cost of mother, you will say it's direct cost. We can trace house tax bill individually on each house, and this house tax bill is supposed to be paid by this mother. So obviously you will say that house tax bill is directly traceable on mother, but indirectly traceable, indirectly allocatable on two brothers. So a cost may behave differently at different point of time, and we need to apportion or allocate cost according to right basis available to us. We need to apply our brain that what shall be the right basis. Now, if somebody asked you in past what is the cost of production, you must have started by saying direct material, direct labor, direct expense, and the total of three you summed up as prime cost, I'm sure. So my question to you is, why you called it prime cost? Why you totaled direct material, direct labor, direct expense? You said that, sir, it's very simple. We are aware that prime minister is main minister. He is main minister of whole cabinet. That's why we call in Hindi pradhan, main. These costs are main cost in cost of production because these can be directly allocatable. You can directly trace them. You can say that, okay, we know that these costs belong to this product and we have no doubt about them. So let's call them prime cost, that okay, these are direct cost, total of direct cost is prime cost that we can calculate. These are primary cost of product. Now we are going on secondary cost, that is apart from prime cost, that is indirect cost. Costs that are not direct cost are known as indirect cost. If you remember cost sheet, you must have added administrative overhead, production overhead, selling and distribution overhead. You are aware about what were they, what were these kind of overheads. You will say, sir, overheads is nothing else but another name of indirect cost. The cost that cannot be directly traceable to a product is known as indirect cost. If I say production, administrative, selling, what is production overhead? Any indirect cost that is utilized in industry, factory, is known as indirect cost. For example, supervisor is supervising factory of Pepsi in Varun Beverages. Two types of bottles are there, one is plastic bottle, another one is glass bottle. So the supervisor is working on both the bottles. So you will say this supervisor cost is indirect cost on production. Although the labor that is directly involved only on bottle manufacturing is known as direct labor, the labor that is involved only on glass manufacturing bottle is known as direct labor for glass. So these are production overhead or work overhead. Then administration means office overhead, means whatever we do in our offices, not in factory, rather in offices. The difference between production and administrative is blue collar employees are obviously factory workers, and white collar means like us are office workers. Then selling overhead and distribution overhead. Selling overhead means advertisements, and distribution overhead means selling expense, selling commission, distribution supply network. For example, you have a very good distribution channel of franchises, so you will incur certain amount of expenditure on that particular network. That expenditure is distribution overhead. So everything, every cost can be direct as well as indirect. If certain cost is incurred, let us say material is incurred only on a particular product, can be traceable on a particular product, then such material will be direct material. If such material is not traceable on a particular product, it will be indirect material. So let's write it fast, then we will proceed. For material, then we will start one by one and we will proceed with direct material. Let's write it fast. Cost. Direct, indirect, also known as prime cost, also known as overheads, costs that are not directly accountable to a cost object, such as a particular project. What is, I'm giving few examples of cost objects, such as particular project, product, facility, or function, rather it has to be assigned in some proportion to all cost centers. Variable and fixed these cost can obviously be it is direct cost, be it is indirect cost, any cost can be fixed as well as variable. We are well aware about these facts. So let me start with relevant cost, calculating relevant cost in production, and let me start with material. First question, what is material? Remember, material is different from finished goods or goods that we trade. What I mean to say, we do not purchase material for selling purpose. So if you purchase a material, you purchase it to transform into finished goods and then sell the finished goods. Remember, the objective of purchasing material is never to sell that material as finished goods, because you are not in trading business, you are in manufacturing business. If trading business is there, obviously it will be finished goods, not material. You will not call it material in that situation, because you are trading it, means you are trading the finished goods. So if certain thing is known as material, it is not meant for selling purpose, for external sales purpose. Exception for this rule is that you, means there is a material that is lying from certain years and is of no use to you. You are thinking about getting rid of that particular material by selling it in scrap, or let us say by selling it at lower price, at whatever price you are getting in market, you will definitely want to, you definitely just want to dispose it. You just want to get rid of such material, then only you will sell it in market. Otherwise, material is always kept for the purpose of transformation into finished goods, and we sell finished goods in products in the market and not material. So what is material? And let me give you example, what is relevant cost of material, not material. For example, in this case, this is filament, this is screw, this is known as screw thread. If you are aware about its name, it is screw thread. We are, let us say, in a company, Philips, that has two kind of materials. There are several kind of materials. Philips is right now in production of bulbs. Earlier they were producing filament bulbs that were also known as incandescent bulb, as something like that only, incandescent or something, I don't remember the name. I will call it as Edison bulb or filament bulb. And second one is, let us say, this LED bulb, because now filament bulb is banned in India, so we are talking about LED bulbs. You think in this way that we have been provided with screw thread, this one is screw thread, and we already have material of screw thread as well as filament. So we will think from both the material perspective that what to do with material screw thread and what to do with material filament, because filament is of no use for us in future. It is lying as it is and we are willing to dispose it off because it is of no use. On the contrary, on the flip side, you will say that screw thread is of very much use to us and it can be definitely used in even our LED bulbs. So this material is useful to us. Let us write few lines, then we will come on to material portion. Company never purchases material with the intention of reselling it. Material is always held with intention of consumption in production process and sells finished goods and not material in market. Raw material is sold in market only in a situation when it is already in stock and there is no future use of such material, and there is no future use of such material. Fine. Now, let me guide you with few cases, and I suppose you must have notes by tomorrow. If you don't have them, kindly download them and get the printouts so that you can read properly, or kindly halt the class for few days until you receive the books so that we can proceed further, because now we are going to discuss with cases. First case is about filament. Let us say you already have filament. Filament is a material that is of no use to you. Let us say last year you purchased 5000 kg of filament, yeah, or 5000 units of filaments. You are Philips. Now what will you do to filament? It is of no use to you. Sir, what to do? We are totally confused, because now Government of India has clearly mentioned that we do not accept any more production of filament bulbs. Only LED bulbs will be produced. I think last year this notification came. Now what to do? We are stuck in middle, because let us say 5 lakh rupees is stuck in this 5000 units of filament. Let us assume all of a sudden there is an order of production of certain thing, let us say of special Diwali lights, wherein this filament can be used in a different manner, let us say in halogen bulbs. So you became very happy that your filament will get utilized now. This was a non-moving item or slow moving item in your factory, and you were willing to get rid of it. Now question to you is, let us assume nobody, you went to market, let us say you came to me and you said that Parag sir, please purchase this filament, I want to get rid of it because I want to make space in my warehouse so that I can put other things, it is consuming my cost of carrying as well and it is no use to me. I said, because filament is of no use, I will pay you only 500 rupees. You said 500 rupees this filament costed me 5 lakh, will you pay me? No, the question is, sir, you are saying just 500 rupees. Now question to you is, first, whether you will, let us say there is no Diwali offer, this just this offer is there that you can only sell it to me and otherwise it is of no use. If we are supposed to think economically, means from financial point of view only, your answer shall be yes sir, we shall accept this offer. Do not think that 5 lakh rupee filament is sold in 500 rupee. Rather think in this way, that 5 lakh rupees is sunk cost. If you will think 5 lakh, you might end up thinking that rather than giving it to 500, I shall dispose of give it to some, let us say, scrap collector without any charges. No, you are at least getting 500. You shall be happy. Never look towards 5 lakh because it is sunk cost. It is making you emotional. I told you in last class as well, sunk cost is the most detrimental cost to us because these kind of costs or accounting treatments can help us in taking wrong decisions. This is clearly a blunder for us. Never think from the point of view of stakeholders. Think from point of view of management. Management will say that I need to empty my spaces. Obviously, from stakeholders' point of view, it is a loss of 4,99,500 rupees. Agreed. Do not look towards their point of view. Rather think that at least we are getting 500 rupees. Because that 5 lakh rupees is sunk in nature, we are not supposed to think about 5 lakh. Okay. Even if, let us say, I don't pay you anything and I say, okay, I will take it up away. I will empty your space. I will not pay you anything. You will say, okay, at least my space will get empty. You take this from it. You do not have any other offer in hand and you know that in future you will not have any offer in hand. Okay, because it is a slow moving item or non-moving item and it is not saleable in market anymore. Now let us say I am providing you 500 rupees. All of a sudden there is an offer to utilize such material and such material will convert into filaments for those halogen bulbs and can be utilized over there. Now, let us assume that 200 is other labor cost apart from this material. 200 is other labor cost apart from this material for this halogen, just 200. What shall be the minimum revenue you shall get on halogen so that you shall not be in worse off situation? That's my question. What minimum price you will quote to customer for halogen so that you shall not be in worse off situation? You will say 700. Why? You will say 200 I will incur in manufacturing of halogen, let us say labor cost, and 500 was my opportunity cost. 500 was my opportunity cost and 200 is my labor cost, so total is 700. You will say, obviously I will say that at least I shall have 700 rupees. So your relevant cost will be 200, opportunity cost will be 500. So while taking a decision, what we need to do is we need to think from point of view of minimum price. If you are calculating relevant cost, think from the point of view of minimum price, that what minimum price we are going to get. If you really want to understand what is the relevant cost, you shall start thinking that what is the minimum price which we shall get so that we shall not be in worse off situation. You will say, obviously 500 rupees or 700 rupees, because out of 700, 200 will spend it. You will spend 200 rupees for labor. You will remaining amount will be just 500 rupees. You will say that at least I earn the same amount of money that I was earning while I was scrapping this material. So I believe I shall stop here itself. I know this screw thread is different from what we have in our country. This might be of some other country, say Singapore, because we have something like this holder where two dots are coming out. But it doesn't create any difference. We understand everything. So in next class, I will explain you about every concept of screw thread as well as material filament, so that we can understand that there are two materials. One is of no use, that is filament, and another one is of regular use, that is screw thread, that can be used for our manufacturing of LED bulbs. So I believe we shall take leave for the day. I hope you enjoyed the class. Let's meet in next class and we will understand material and labor concepts in a very wonderful manner. Bye bye for the way. Tata.